Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. And Pam Gosal and Stephanie Callahan are joining us online, and we've received apologies from Mark Griffin. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members all agreed? We're agreed. Thank you. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the committee's annual review of MPF4 from two panels of witnesses. On our first panel, we're joined by Ian Aikman, who is the chair at Heads of Planning Scotland, and David Gervin, who is the chief planning officer at the City of Edinburgh Council. And we're joined online by Morag Ferguson, who is a planning manager, and Mary McIver, who's a development plan manager at Corlianan Ilian Shear. And I welcome all our witnesses to our meeting, and I love the backdrops of the folks that are online. That's really lovely. Thank you for that. Before we move to questions, I wanted to remind members and those participating today in today's session that there are current active legal proceedings concerning the interpretation of MPF4 policies and the interaction between these policies and existing local plans. And under the Parliament standing orders, a member may not, in proceedings of the Parliament, refer to any matter in relation to which legal proceedings are active, except to the extent permitted by the presiding officer. And whilst we do not wish discussion and debate to be unduly restricted today, I'd ask members and witnesses to avoid referencing specific matters that are currently before the court. And we're going to turn to questions, but I just want to say that we'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible. But if you would like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks. And Morag and Murray, can you let us know that you want to come in by typing an R in the chat function? Also, there's no need for you to turn your microphones on and off. Our broadcast team will do that for us. And just to say, Morag and Murray, there might be a slight delay as your mic turns on. Don't worry about that. We're aware of the pause. And I would like to begin with a couple of questions. So one of the things that the committee keeps hearing is a call for the Scottish Government to establish a hierarchy of the MPF4. And I think I'll direct this to you, Ian, for starters, so you know it's coming to you. So to establish a hierarchy of MPF4 policy priorities, and the idea of that would be to assist decision makers and developers. And I'd be interested to hear if you think that is a good approach, and if so, why? Or if not, why?
Good morning. It's one of these ones that, as an organisation, Hops, there's probably a variety of views, but I will temper that by trying to come provide you with the broad view, but I may dip in occasion into my own as Chief Planning and Housing Officer at Scottish Borders Council in terms of the particular reference. In terms of a hierarchy of policy, I think the view is that probably a formal one is not absolutely necessary. We need to read the document as an entity, as a whole, holistically, and balance the range of policies that are within there. And indeed, that is what we do as planning professionals, is to balance those competing elements and look at the local circumstances that apply to a particular development and apply that accordingly. And that is looking at those key principles of sustainable, livable and productive places and looking at, as you say, that holistic approach and accommodating those local situations and taking account of those local factors. So I don't think really there is. It's something which will, by its nature, evolve as we get a broader caseload of applications coming through the system and the application of the policies against those.
Okay, thanks for that. So it's something about the bedding in of this new policy framework and a kind of understanding of how they all work together.
I think so. And it is something you probably hear on numerous occasions, that it's still fairly early days. It's a bit of a transitional process where we're working our way through what these policies mean and the implications of those, yes.
Okay, thanks very much for that. If no one else has an opinion on the hierarchy, I'm going to move on to my next question. I don't see anyone jumping at that. Okay, so the other thing that we've been hearing is from witnesses is that the need for planning authorities to take a proportionate approach to the amount of information required to support a planning application. And especially in the light of the new MPF4 requirements around climate and biodiversity. I'd be interested to hear from yourselves, and I'll start with David for a change. Do you have a sense that local authorities are adopting such a proportionate approach? And if not, could you give us an understanding of why that's not happening and what would we need to be doing to minimise the amount of supporting information required?
I think that local authorities always take a proportionate approach when they're looking at planning applications, and they'll be looking at the scale and the context of those applications and deciding what's appropriate an appropriate level of information to seek. When we look at what's required to get an application validated, the threshold is relatively low. What's needed to get an application determined is often different, I think. But I think that, you know, we would certainly across the board, I think, be taking quite different approaches from small scale applications. And you know, obviously we're dealing with the range from householders right through to major and national developments. And so I think the level of information that we seek is going to be proportionate in relation to that. And also in relation to, I suppose, the kind of shifts in policy emphasis that are brought about by MPF4. So there may be new things that we're looking at or looking at in a slightly different way as a result of MPF4, and obviously the nature and climate crisis come to the fore through policy one and permeate the plan as a result.
Okay, thanks. Morag or Mari, would one of you like to come in on this? I see Morag nodding. Do you want to come in?
Yes, thank you. Just to follow on that, I mean, I think National Planning Framework 4 has definitely increased awareness and focus on climate change and biodiversity, but it's also introduced a lot of uncertainty over what planning and planners can do and are required to do for the vast majority of applications, which are small scale and minor developments in our island authority area. So there is a challenge over proportionality and when to seek information post-validation at a time when the challenges to delivering development on the ground have become much greater and the resource and expertise available to small development management teams has never been so stretched. Planning courses are not producing graduates with expertise in climate change, flood risk and biodiversity. And small authorities like ours do not have those experts in-house. And the organisations that historically provided you with guidance, such as Nature Scot and SEPA, are pulling back their consultation input to focus on large projects, which is understandable. And, you know, our feeling is that the National Planning Policy Framework has really been created with large-scale development in mind, whereas the reality is that the vast majority of applications for development in island and remote areas are small. And it can be difficult for development management teams working at the coal face to just find that balance between reading reams of, you know, policy and guidance for small-scale development. There are exceptions given to householder developments, but there are probably as many, if not more, other minor-scale developments in our areas. That, you know, where, you know, a proportional approach needs to be taken.
Thanks so much for that. And thanks for highlighting the kind of challenge in a way that MPF4, from your perspective, has a focus on kind of larger projects and doesn't really meet the needs for smaller projects. Do you, and you talked about the kind of stretched capacity of planners and also the fact that at the moment there aren't people coming through necessarily with that understanding of climate and biodiversity through training. Are there any things that you, I can imagine that you talk with other planning authorities that are working on smaller scale projects more consistently. Have you kind of identified any kind of short term or medium term solutions that we could look at in order to help with that capacity and the support for taking the proportionate approach?
I think there's obviously like a training aspect to it. But again, like finding the space to do in-house training is challenging at the moment. there are obviously, like, you can develop pro formas to, you know, help less experienced staff navigate the policy. But I think it's just the sheer scale of information. So the policies themselves are voluminous. There's then a lot of guidance behind that. And while there isn't a hierarchy of policies, the focus on biodiversity and climate change in particular, in terms of these policies being very upfront in the document, they've obviously been debated a lot, and they are threaded through, you know, as cross-cutting themes and lots of other policies. It does mean that actually they have kind of come high up in priority in the agenda for planners.
Okay, thanks. Ian.
To pick up on some of the points Morag was making, and I think it would certainly agree with everything that was said. I think there obviously is, as an organisation which supports our membership around the country, we have been doing, along with the Improvement Service and Scottish Government, looking at a range of options to provide some of that training and skills and to share that information and do a bit of benchmarking. So certainly there was an event held earlier this year where we had a, you know, several hundred planning officers from all around the country providing. So there's a real demand and need for that, but it's something we need to continue to do because, as has been said, you know, it is really, you know, biodiversity and climate change is the lens through which we must make our decisions. So officers have to be, to have the skills and the knowledge to both determine and deal with applications, but engage with developers and advise them what is required to make a determination so that we are getting something which is pragmatic and proportionate in terms of the information they need to provide us with.
Now, do you feel like that's, so it's great to hear that there's that training is happening. Do you feel it's sufficiently resourced to keep that going? It sounds like from what Morag is saying, we need that kind of to go on.
It needs to be an ongoing programme. Yeah. There needs to be more. We had a start, and I'd say certainly the feedback from those sessions was very positive, but we need to make sure that we've got a programme moving forward to make sure that we have the skills available for our staff.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey. A couple of questions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everybody. I'd like to ask for your thoughts on the six broad principles of NPF4, and for just to remind everyone, including ourselves, these are just transition, conserving and recycling, local living, compact urban growth, rebalanced development, and rural revitalisation. Could you share any examples of any early signs of embracing these broad principles, either in your own local areas or from your knowledge of other areas, just to give the committee a sense of whether we're beginning to embrace these ideas? Maybe David, would you like to kick off?
Yeah, I think in Edinburgh, the development of the city probably over the last 20 years has been moving towards, and some cases kind of achieved the principles that are set out. So if you think about the one on compact urban growth, I think there's been a real focus in Edinburgh on that over the last sort of 10, 15 years. And we see redevelopment of areas like Bonington, like Leith, Fountain Bridge, Quarter Mile, and so on. And often the redevelopment is higher density or high-density living, but supported by a range of different types of uses surrounding it. So you're getting integration, which I think is a really positive thing. And I think what NPF4 is doing is massively reinforcing that as a principle. So I think that is that's a really important thing. And I think that, you know, you could look at some of these other headings these principles in the same kind of way. Where I think that, you know, it's very helpful in kind of promoting the a sustainable agenda, I guess. So yeah, it's a good thing, but it's, as I would say, in Edinburgh, it's kind of building on what's or helping us build on what's already happening.
Yeah. Slightly different. So, as context, obviously, I deal with a rural area, so maybe I'll pick up on rural revitalisation. Obviously, the link within NPF4, but also the Planning Act as well, about the need for local place planning, it's certainly something we've seen significant interest in that, and how that relates to town centres, how it relates to employment mobility, how it relates to the connections, particularly if I can pick up some of the themes from the south of Scotland. Obviously, as Alison Dumfries and Galloway, we're involved in what's known as Team South of Scotland, where we're looking at pulling together a range of opportunities through the green economy, looking at housing piece as well, because our situation is somewhat different. So there's a number of things that have flown from that. But I think that bit about local place planning and that community resilience and communities engaging with the process, that is something which I think will help us as we move forward. We can just say it's happened just now, but it's something that is going to build in terms of those community aspirations and the ability to feed into the next round of local development plans about what communities want, what they need, and how we actually link and on a rural, in a rural context. So it is, there's a number of things that flow from that. Obviously, some of the bits and pieces about compact urban growth and other things relate to on a different scale in a local, in a rural context. But the rural revitalisation, I think that focus and having these spatial principles there, I think provides us the focus to actually develop policies and engage with communities, saying these are the things that we want to see happen, what do you want to see happen, and how can we sort of work together to deliver that collaborative element of it that I see coming through that.
Thank you very much for that. Could I turn to Morag and Mary to offer a view on whether we are beginning to see local communities embracing these broad principles, particularly in your area up in the Western Isles?
Thank you, Chair. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Just coming in on the back of the comments there around local place plans, for example, you said this is a really valuable tool. You'll be aware that we already have a large percentage of our land, over 75% in community land ownership or community asset ownership already. And we welcome that this first round of local place plans is permitting existing community plans to come forward, provided they meet the validation, obviously. So we have a large established community enterprise here already that's responding to the opportunities of local place plans. But just another observation really around some of the tools that are within MPF. I'm thinking specifically about the rural urban classification. This has been a tool that's perhaps worked against us in that it's in some parts conflicting with our existing development strategy, our own LDP's spatial strategy, or in some areas it's opening up areas for development just because of they're tied to geographical areas that aren't suitable for development. So just an observation around that. Thank you.
Morag?
I think just maybe go and bring in your next question.
Morag, do you want to come in on that question? Just on how we are embracing the six principles in MPF4. Local living, rural revitalisation, are beginning to see these principles being embraced by local communities and authorities?
I think rural revitalisation is a long-term ambition. Our authority is one of two with a significantly declining population, and it's going to take a period of time before we start to see the results of MPF4. We are working with other sections of the government, particularly on housing, because housing is seen as being essential in order to be able to provide affordable homes, in order to be able to further to be sufficient population of working age to grow and develop businesses. It will take time to bed in, and I mean, it is early days.
Okay. One or two of you have already mentioned local place plans and so on, and how do you see them ultimately influencing the local development plans that the authorities have had for many, many years? Are you beginning to see an influence taking place already, either in your own area or from your knowledge again? And can you maybe share a few thoughts about how that process will work or should should work here.
Yeah, you're looking at me, so I was assuming I was coming in. Certainly, we've seen a real enthusiasm for local place planning in the boards. We probably had about 80% of our settlements communities saying they're looking to engage and are looking at preparing a local place plan. We have four coming forward at the moment that are based on the Borderlands towns, Hoyk, Jedburgh, Eyemouth, and in Galashiels. How can I forget Galashiels? Where there's obviously funding behind that as well. So obviously that is one where we've got the Hoyk place plan coming up to council because it's linked to a funding package in June. But there's a number that are bubbling under, and a number of communities that are very clear in terms of that, of supporting that process. In terms of influencing, one it is. We have, as a council, invested in a couple of local place planning officers within my team, but we've also got our community planning officers and engagement officers. So we've been looking at creating a process where we're in a constant conversation with our communities about what they want and what they need. So there's a big dialogue happening, and we can't ignore that dialogue. So it will have to influence the plans coming forward. But it's a dialogue on the basis that this is a positive process. It's not about NIMBYism. It's not about using that as a mechanism to stop things happening. It's saying, well, what are the things we need to make happen? Some of it will come through the planning process. Some of it will come through other mechanisms, but actually, in many cases, you're creating a bidding document as well for other funds that are coming through, whether it's levelling up or whatever else that's there. So it's actually creating that enthusiasm within communities and that, I suppose, that trust in communities, because that's a big thing to get, is the trust of the communities that actually things are going to be delivered. So there's a big emphasis in terms of us needing to follow through on this as well. But I'm very encouraged by what I've seen in my authority so far about the development of local place plans and that link to placemaking.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Ian. Maria, you want to come in on this?
Yes, again, I just concur with the comments that have been made there. It is definitely a positive tool for communities to become engaged in the planning process. But equally, we'd be keen to let communities know that there is other, they don't have to have that tangible document. There is other mechanisms for them to be engaged with the development plan process. They don't have to formalise that. I did take a bit of a kind of consensus from other authorities before coming into these sessions today. We have a positive North of Scotland Development Plans Forum where we share a kind of good practice and thoughts. And some of the kind of feedback I had from other rural and island authorities, and I suspect this goes across the piece for other authorities, there is still some confusion about, you know, what's the cut-off on local place plans? We've had the consultation out just now on amendments to local development plans and when they might incur a review, for example. So there is confusion about at what point, you know, is the cut-off for local place plans. For our authority, we've asked communities to come in with an indication on their local place plans before we go forward with our evidence report to the gate check process. But I think it must drift into the local plan preparation process as well. So a positive tool, but yet to see all the benefits of it, I think.
Okay, thanks, Mary. David, from Edinburgh's perspective, a local place plan in Edinburgh will be totally different from a local place plan in, say, Barra. Could you maybe share a little bit of a contrast for
absolutely.
Us?
Absolutely. So we've had one local place plan so far in the West of Hales area, but that was a place plan that was supported. And then there's two others, I think, that are underway, one in Queen's Ferry and one in Gilmerton. So the uptake in Edinburgh has been relatively low, I think, when you consider the scale of the city and the size of the population. And I think that is an area of concern, because I do think that local place plans are a positive development. As I see it, it is an iterative process, the idea that the community are looking at the development plan and thinking about what that means and what the future might be. And then for us then, when we're preparing plans, to be taking that into account. And so the situation would continue as development plans are replaced in the future. But I think there is a concern from communities that they're potentially difficult or complex documents to make, and that they need support. And I think I don't think it needs to necessarily be that way. I think they can be quite simple documents potentially. And I think helping communities with that is a thing that I think should be explored. But I also think that, you know, these documents take time to prepare, and the support that's available to certain communities will be different from the support that's available in others, just from within the communities themselves. So I think that's also something that needs to be considered. And the final point I would make would be that I think there does need to be a separation from the planning authority in terms of its role in preparing the development plan and the community in preparing the local place plan. And I think that there's a concern I would have around us being overly involved in the development of place plans as councils, as planning authorities, in that it might kind of muddy the waters in terms of that overall process. So I think that's another factor that needs to be considered.
Yeah. Can I just ask one final question of you that's not encroaching on other colleagues' questions? Do you think all these plans and strategies and local place plans and so on should have a role in how we improve the look and feel of our high streets and our towns and villages in Scotland? Because when I talk to people, local people, about this stuff, they look at me and say, how's it going to improve what we see around us? You see urban dereliction, empty shops, abandonment and so on. And that was a theme running through our discussion on MPF4 over the last year or so that we were considering it. Should people rightly have an expectation that it should reach that kind of area and try to address and solve some of those problems? Because if not, then some may ask, particularly people that live in the urban setting, they might say, what's been the point of this? Are you aware of that type of issue and about that kind of town centre high street issue that we have, and how these principles can reach out and try to solve some of that?
Sorry, in terms of, I suppose, drawing on my own experience, if I refer to the work that Energise Galashiels are doing, they have been award-winning in terms of some of the work they've done. They've been looking at the challenges of decline in the town centre, looking at a range of projects. So that is one where you've got real action and energy from that organisation to make things better. I think they accept that not all of that will come through the local development plan process or will come through planning, and that there's a range of partners that need to be involved in that process. Planning is a fundamental part of that, but they use the documents, or they use the document as a tool to draw in other things. So that's made the point earlier about the need for that broader council communication, because it may be other services within the council that can help provide some of those things, but also it can be looking at how do we bid for funding, how do we look at bids in general in terms of these town centre areas. So that's a community organisation which obviously is almost like a town team, which is an enthusiastic and organisation who are looking at a whole series of innovative ways to use the tools available to them, and place planning is one of those tools. So there are examples there where that's happening. The challenge, I suppose, with, and it's maybe touched on by others, is that not all communities have that resource to do that, and it's how can we engage and support the communities who are less well off, don't have the capacity to do these. But I think I'd pick up on David's point that they don't necessarily need to be another development plan. They could actually be a few sheets with a few plans of actions. Here are things we want to see done. How do we get them done? Who do we need to contact to do that? Who are the key owners of those areas? So it's a focus for action, would be my view. So they can be tempered, but they don't need to be another development plan. That's not what the point is.
Yeah, thanks very much for that.
Okay.
Any perspective from yourself on that, David, particularly with the urban setting, where local people might want to see improvements?
I think I would echo Ian's comments about planning being part of the picture in terms of the revitalisation of town centres. So I think to that extent, local place plans, because of their development focus, can have a bearing on that. I think the other thing that will happen with local place plans is I think they will go beyond just talking about development in planning terms and discuss other matters. And I think when we receive those as planning authorities, the onus is on us to think about, well, what do we do with that? And often that will be, I think, potentially referring them on to other service areas within councils to say, this community said this about this area, and this isn't really a planning matter, but you should be aware of that. And that might help influence how other services within councils take decisions.
If there's no other requests,
no,
I don't think so. Okay, thanks very much for your response to those questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol, who's joining us online.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, panel. As you probably know, Scotland's experiencing a housing emergency, and as you probably have heard, that five councils have declared a housing emergency in Scotland. Sadly, two of these councils are, in my region, in the west of Scotland. And we've heard from evidence in the committee the best way to tackle this emergency is to increase the supply of homes. So my question is around brownfield sites. Could that play an important role in helping increase this supply by providing space for new developments to be built? And do you believe that the NPF4 is having any impact on the willingness of developers to build on brownfield sites?
David, why don't you go? You might have a few brownfields in your portfolio.
Probably building on what I said earlier, in Edinburgh, I think we've got a pretty good track record of developing brownfield land. So as I said before, you know, areas like Leith and Bonnington, there's been a real series of developments there over the last 10, 15, 20 years. And what we're seeing with that is often quite high density developments. What you're doing there is you're getting very effective use of land. You're bringing new people into communities that will help support local shops and other services within areas. Sometimes there can be impacts as a result of that, you know, when we think about things like doctor surgeries and schools and so on that we need to look at through or are looking at through the planning system. So I think NPF4 is because of the kind of climate policies and the policy on brownfield is helping to support that kind of development, which I think is a very positive thing. And I think that you know, we've got a range of house builders who've been involved in developing brownfield land, both in the public sector, but particularly in the private sector as well. And I think, again, that's positive because we're getting housing with a range of tenures. And in Edinburgh, we've been achieving our 25% affordable housing again. So that's a very positive thing when we think about the housing emergency that the City of Edinburgh Council has declared.
Thanks for that, David. Morag, I wanted to bring you in and see if you have a brownfield, what's going on in brownfield sites in your part of Scotland.
Thank you. We don't have a huge portfolio of brownfield sites, but we have one which is just starting development at the moment, which was a former RAF site at near Stornoway Airport. We consented it just coming up for 3 years ago, and that'll certainly it's a kind of 45 house development. And you know, round about the town of Stornoway, we have delivered quite a significant number of what we term large scale developments in the last, you know, 5 years in particular. One of the kind of challenges, I suppose, that we're seeing coming through for our members is that there is a desire to have facilities within those developments, such as shops, but the viability of having like a local shop for that kind of number of houses is questionable. So there's a kind of like economies of, you know, like just getting the development of the right scale that's appropriate to our environment versus them being able to be communities in their own right. In the more rural areas, there are, you know, not a lot of brownfield sites. I think people tend to build like on crofts, they'll build a new house rather than redevelop an old house. And part of that is fiscal because of VAT. And part of it is just to do with the fact that the footprint of the challenges of retrofitting insulation to what would have been a house of a fairly small footprint does not provide like a house that's desired for, you know, for today's way of living.
Gordon MacDonald, I think you might have a supplementary on brownfield sites.
Yeah, yeah, thanks very much, convener. David, I wanted to ask you for getting the balance right in Edinburgh between building on greenfield and using brownfield sites. I've been looking at this for 10 years, and you're right, Edinburgh has improved the situation with brownfield sites, but there are still enough sites in Edinburgh to build 1,300 houses if you look at the current register of derelict and vacant land, yet we're building on greenfield sites where we're in a country that can't feed its population and on good arable land. Are we getting the balance right? And second, my second part of the question is, I notice a lot of the sites, there is a problem with identifying ownership, and how much of a difficulty is that across the country?
In terms of the balance, I think we are getting it right. I think we have shifted in Edinburgh. If you look at our last local development plan, there were more greenfield releases within that. There was some in the west of the city. There was some in the southeast. Whereas our emerging local development plan, it's just had its examination report, has looked at development that was already, or land that was already earmarked for development next to the A8 and between the airport. The West Edinburgh area as greenfield land that is being developed, but what we're looking at there is making sure that is again high density development. So the numbers of houses that we're looking on that are high, and are much higher in density than those previous releases that I just mentioned. So I think that where there is greenfield land that is being used for housing, making sure that's done in the most effective way. So in West Edinburgh, as I say, high density, but also making use of the transport infrastructure. So we have tram, we've got heavy rail, we've got a road network that can support public transport, and well, buses already does, as well as connections into active travel networks. So I think to that extent, we are getting that balance right. In terms of the land ownership issues, that isn't an issue that I've come across to any great degree in Edinburgh. Mostly the developers will be in control of their sites, and they'll have assembled them by the time that they're coming into planning. Sometimes get little issues that emerge when we're signing Section 75 legal agreements, but it's not been a major theme. We have looked at, certainly the council has looked at compulsory purchase powers, where there are little tracts of land that might prevent a development from happening, and those powers are explored and sometimes used to make sure that development can proceed. But as I say, I wouldn't say that's been a major theme.
Just the register highlights about 18% of the derelict land in Edinburgh, and most of it might be small patches. Is ownership unknown?
Right. It's an interesting comment you're making. I think that's something I'd want to take away and reflect on for the city.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Gordon. Pam, I want to bring you back in.
Thank you, Chair. Ian, I wanted to ask you, and it's good to hear, obviously, the things that are happening in certain areas, but overall, what's your view on the brownfield sites? With is the NPFO supporting developers to come forward with brownfield sites?
I think there's certainly a clear imperative within NPFO to develop brownfield land, and obviously that is probably clearer now than it was previously. But in terms of developers coming forward, I don't think we're necessarily in Edinburgh, you've heard the Edinburgh context, but out with the Edinburgh context, that we've necessarily seen that. A lot of the brownfield land and vacant and derelict land is in areas where there's real market fragility. So therefore, the ability to develop those sites and make them viable is far more challenging. And that's both in urban areas through in the west, but also in rural areas as well. A brilliant example we're just dealing with recently, where we put together a scheme with a local housing provider, and we put the package together, and at the last minute, the sort of vacant derelict land funding has become questionable whether that will come through. So that's a site for 30 to 40 houses in a local area. So that would have been a clear brownfield development. So there are challenges in making those sites viable, and there is a need for that public investment within it to help them happen. So it is difficult to say at this stage whether more developers are coming forward in other areas, but obviously you've heard the Edinburgh context where there's a clear focus on that. But where you don't have that market viability and you've got significant remediation costs, then it is far more challenging to develop those areas. I suppose in a borders context, historically, we've built on a lot of our former industrial past. Most of that is in river floors. We've got most of our villages and towns are in river valleys. So the issue then comes into actually the new provisions in terms of policies relating to flooding. And that makes it even more complicated, I would say.
Thank you, Ian. Chair, could I ask my supplementary?
Yes.
Is that okay? Thank you, Chair. It was recently reported that the Scottish Government has not undertaken any internal work to calculate new build plans or projections. What, if any, evidence is there that the policies set out in NPF4 are supporting the delivery of new homes? And do you believe that the Scottish Government ought to undertake work projecting the number of homes needed to be built in Scotland? Do you want to start off, Ian, or whoever?
I suppose I'm sort of struggling a little to obviously the focus that we've got obviously through NPF4 is the Mantler figures on housing projections, and that is the basis that we are now working to. We'll set aside legal cases and potential implications of that at the moment. That's still being pondered. But obviously that sets out what our sort of target is, and obviously through the development plan processes moving forward, we'll be doing a lot of that work locally to build up our evidence reports in terms of what is required in the local context, because that will vary significantly around the country. So that is work that local authorities were doing. Whether there's a specific need for Scottish Government to do that work, that's certainly work we would do in combination with them. We would do it collaboratively, but the focus clearly is now pulling together the evidence reports for the next phase of local development plans. But I don't know, David might actually have more insights into some of that.
Yeah, I think we're in the same position, looking at we're in the final stages of our current plan, and I think NPF4 is the numbers within that for housing kind of coincide with what we've got in our proposed development plan. So that's a positive. And I think the move away from some of the policies that were in the previous in SPP and so on have been helpful. And I think there's encouragement to support development plans and the way that they're framing where housing should be. I think that there's stronger support in the plan, and we're moving away from the potential for that we've been in the past in Edinburgh, where we've been in a kind of planning by appeal situation due to the requirements around five-year housing land supply. So I think there's a lot of positive things there. Whether specific studies or work should be done by government, I think, as Ian says, that is something that we would expect to happen in collaboration with local authorities, because there's obviously a real local dimension to all of that. So if that was to emerge, I think we would want to work with our counterparts in government on that.
Okay. Gordon, very brief supplementary.
Very, very,
very
quickly.
Very brief.
Housing needs and demand assessment. How often is that carried out to identify the number of homes required in any particular council area?
I'd have to check it's something obviously we do reasonably regularly, and certainly in Edinburgh, it's the housing needs of the city are a major focus of our work, both in the planning service and with our colleagues in housing. So we work closely with them on that, but the precise frequency of that I'd have to report back on.
Thanks very much for that. Mary, you've indicated you want to come in on these last points.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, just actually come in on the point around the Mathler approach, just to advise that that is really, I appreciate small and rural and island authorities are not making the contribution to the housing demand that in terms of national figures. However, the housing that we do deliver in these in our areas is hugely impactful and is a vital tool in as sustaining and revitalising our communities. But just that there's a thought amongst rural and island authorities that the Mathler tool was really just a far too crude a measure for determining or projecting housing land requirement for our areas. There was rounding elements within it and the numbers are so small, it really didn't work for us. Just to come on the second point around the Honda, we're fortunate that we've worked very closely with our housing team and they're fortuitously just ahead of us in their local housing strategy and Honda process. So we have a valid Honda, which again kind of argues against where the Mathler doesn't work for us. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. That's very helpful. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs with a number of questions.
Yeah, good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us here and online today. I wanted to ask a question with regards to some of the concerns we've heard as a committee in the wording around some MPF4 policies, which people have stated are unclear, and just wondered if there's any examples you have yourselves of that which you'd like to see improved. If not, then move on to another question.
Don't think too hard if there's anything that jumps out.
If I can comment on that, I think the wording is probably clear, but sometimes it's quite wide-ranging. So if you take that policy one, it's a very broad brush policy, isn't it? Very aspirational. And then you see it permeating the other policies. And then some of the policies are quite detailed. And I think what we're finding is we're working through as a as planning authorities, as the DPA involved as well, the interpretation of these policies is something that's kind of been worked through. So we've mentioned the flooding policy, where I think there's particular challenges around the interpretation of that. So I think on that, where there that can be resolved potentially by additional guidance to help with the interpretation of the wording.
If I can come in, just agree with that. Obviously, it's been a year of getting used to new things. It is a fundamental change in planning policy, probably in our careers, both in terms of the Act, but obviously MPF4 as well, and that clear focus on, you say, climate and biodiversity, but a whole range of other things that flow from that. I don't necessarily have an issue with the clarity of the wording. I think would it have been ideal to have had most of the guidance come out at the same time? Yes, of course it would be. But I suppose that's what we do as planners and decision makers is work our way through and come to determination on these and interpret them. And actually, I've never seen a document that is wholly consistent all the way through. There are policies which obviously clash against each other, understandably. That's the nature of the wide range of things that we have to deal with. But that is a national policy, but obviously there's a lot of local context within that. So the interpretations, I think, will be slightly different in different areas, and it's legitimate for it to be so. So, one, we would have liked more guidance, and there's areas where we're working with government, and they've been very supportive in that in terms of working way through things in terms of housing, but also in terms of flooding, some of the renewables implications and other things. We're working through with them, and in fact, there was a session last week just going through some of these questions with government. So we will work through that and get a handle on it. But it's by its nature, it's a bit of a learning as you go along, and actually some of that will come through determinations for cases, some of it will be through DPE decisions, but I think there's a willingness for us to work through a lot of these areas with government. There's a few areas we'd like them to provide more guidance on, yes, but we'll sort of
I think we will get there. And over the next, you know, we're only a year in, so there's a lot to work our way through. And I think we're starting to do some of that. So in the next sort of year to 2 years, hopefully when we come, well, others will be coming back because I'm retiring soon, before you to see how things are progressing, they'll be able to provide a more detailed picture in terms of that. A lot at the moment is just learning. It's that transitional period. It's actually just trying to work our way through what these things mean. But as mentioned, been mentioned by various colleagues, there's a lot of benchmarking going on and sharing of good practice amongst authorities. But obviously, say the Scottish Government has certainly been very willing, their officials, to work with us in terms of working through some of the challenging areas and the problem areas.
To see how things develop a year from now. Mary, you've indicated you want to come in.
I think Ian really has covered the points I was going to make. Yes, there was probably some wording that's looser than we would have liked. There's some use of should, as far as possible. That does leave some ambiguity or a lack of clarity for both applicants and planners. But against the comments Ian made around balancing development and for the authorities to put weight on it, I think it will be clearer once a whole cycle of LDPs come in sync with MPF as well, because just now there is some conflict about the stringency of some policies in local development plans as opposed to what's in MPF. Thank you.
Thank you for that. And I hope MPF4 hasn't driven you to early retirement, Ian, but we'll leave that maybe to one side. I wondered as well, and this touched upon what you said earlier, David, in terms of how MPF4 can move towards a delivery of an infrastructure-first approach. And I think for many of us, Gordon and myself represent Edinburgh and the Lothians, we've seen huge amounts of development take place in terms of new-build homes, but not necessarily the corresponding infrastructure. And just wondered if there's examples of how this has helped, or MPF4 might help move towards that, and whether or not you've seen that change coming forward.
Well, again, in Edinburgh, the delivery of infrastructure is very much part of what we do within the planning team, within the council. So we look at, we've got policies and guidance that supports that around the delivery of education infrastructure, for tram contributions, for transport, and for affordable housing, as well as healthcare. So that's kind of part and parcel of what's already happening. But I think the infrastructure first policy, again, just kind of helps to strengthen that. And I suppose even the terminology of infrastructure first kind of emphasises the need for that infrastructure to be in there early, so that it's available for when it needs to be used. So it kind of, in that sense, I suppose it strengthens our arm.
I don't know if anyone else wanted to add to that. I know we're short on time, so I'll ask my last question, which was potentially more for the island and rural councils, and that was with regards to conflicting evidence on the balance struck between MPF4, protecting areas with carbon-rich soils and the development of renewable energy infrastructure. And just wondered what your views were on this and whether or not they are competing. That was something certainly we took evidence on the climate emergency and nature emergency. Sometimes in terms of planning, rubbing up against each other within MPF4. So just wondered if you had any views on that specifically. Bring you in, Ian.
I think that's one of the ones I was sort of touching on, and I suppose my last response is that there are areas where policies do clash up against each other. I think certainly the renewables policy is far more permissive than it was. It is obviously, and the whole policy basis of policy one in terms of climate change, that is the key emphasis. So in terms of the balance is probably more in favour of the delivery of these types of projects. But again, it is a complex picture, and I think that's one of the areas we're still working our way through. And actually, I think there's a session on some of this later on today with colleagues in government and with colleagues from some of the rural authorities, Dumfries and Galloway, Aberdeenshire Highland and Moray, who are dealing with some of that
So it's not one I can give you a definitive answer on. There are potential clashes there, and I think we'll see some of that play out in terms of the decisions and cases that are coming forward. But we're trying to work through our way through that. But yes, but certainly the basis of the policy is far more permissive, and therefore the challenges of opposing an application on that basis are more difficult.
Morag or Mary? Morag, maybe, do you want to come in on that? Or is it more Mary's thing? Morag.
Yes, I mean, I would agree with what Ina said there. I mean, obviously, there is the policy is very permissive of renewable development, and we're an area which is largely covered in peat. So, you know, the developers are experiencing quite a challenge in meeting the policy requirements. There is, you know, a school of thought that, you know, that renewable development shouldn't happen on peat, but that's quite difficult where most of our landmass, certainly in the northern part of the Outer Hebrides, is peat. I think, again, like, it's going to take time. We're working with a number of developers and really, like, struggling through the guidance and, you know, again, like, just the volume of it, and there is, you know, a need to kind of bring the guidance together, because CEPA's position and CEPA's guidance and Nature Scots guidance are coming at the issue in two different ways. And for example, just the sheer scale of additional land you would require to carry out reinstatement based on the Nature Scot policy is going to be difficult to achieve. The kind of flip side of that is that we are, you know, working with developers of non-renewables to do on the soils policy, and there is, I suppose, like, a feeling of inequality if a very major national scale development is going to be allowed to disturb huge quantities of peat, and we're pressing them to find alternative sites in order to avoid peat. The kind of, I suppose, like, the methodology for dealing with peat and peat reinstatement was developed on wind farm sites, and it doesn't carry over all that easily sometimes to other smaller scale developments in terms of the plant that's required, or, you know, the sheer cost of moving peat around and carrying out reinstatement. It can add quite significantly to the cost of a community-led development, for example.
Okay, yeah, thank you for the very useful points. The challenge of where the wind blows, there's lots of peat in quite a lot of Scotland. I'm now going to bring in Gordon MacDonald with a couple of questions.
Thanks very much, Convener. I've got a couple of areas I want to ask about. The first one is to do with the building of quality homes. We all want good quality homes to be built, but we know there's pressure on developers, and certainly in my caseload, I've had a couple of recent new developments that have had problems. Speaking to construction guys, part of the problem is during winter, roofs are not tarpaulined and the rafters are getting wet before the roof actually goes on and things like that, and that leads to problems later down the line. So my question is, does MPF 4 support the building of quality homes, and is there enough checks and balances in the systems to know that what developers are building are being built to the highest quality?
If I could come in on that, I think it supports it in terms of you know, there's a policy 16 on quality homes, and then there's policies on design, and then there's all the other policies that support, you know, sort of nature positive spaces, all that kind of stuff that will help make place and make successful place. So I think to that extent, it does a good job. It's very supportive on that front, and again, sort of chimes with what we're trying to do or have been doing in Edinburgh. I think in terms of the construction of homes, as I see it, that's very substantially a matter for contractors themselves and the industry to be making sure that they are building to appropriate standards and are delivering on the good quality construction. And then, of course, there is a role for building standards in that as verifiers and through the process of reasonable inquiry as in site inspection. But as I see it, it's a relatively limited role, and really the onus is on the contractors and the industry to make sure that buildings are being built properly. And if we think about the big objectives around climate change, when we get to the detail of buildings, that's something about how they're built will determine whether or not they're actually fulfilling. You know, if you don't get the insulation installed right or the right level, then that house isn't going to perform as well. But as a planning service, that isn't something that would ever be easier. Maybe it's not even possible for us to enforce. I think there's a lot of challenge around that. So I think having clarity about what planning can do, which is, in my mind, is about the siting of development, as you're talking about making really good quality places, and the development therefore having longevity, I think it can support all of that. But in terms of the detail, I think building standards has got a role, but I certainly think the development and the construction industry has got a strong role itself.
Given the amount of development that's happening, particularly in the East, and I'll maybe bring Ian in at this point, is what are the challenges facing planning departments?
Well, in the broadest sense, the simple bit is having enough planners to deal with that. Having the right enough planners of the right age, if I can be ageist at my age, and having the skills and knowledge available. So therefore, that whole point about resourcing planning services to both deal with the current duties, but obviously the uncosted duties that were delivered through the adoption of the Planning Act. So that whole the whole point about actually making sure that planning services have the right number of people with the right skills to be able to deal with these applications as efficiently as possible, and making sure that we're getting the good development that David's referring to. So that is probably the most fundamental issue that we have in terms of that number of applications and the type and scale, because we're talking about housing there, but actually my authority, probably the most complex things we deal with are the renewables applications. We've got, so that's a significant piece of our workload, and having the skills, again, I've just had my key officer retire who's dealt with this, so we're often to upskill officers to deal with that. So, but that whole point about resources and skills and knowledge,
I mean, is there a particular difficulty in attracting planners to work for local authorities, or is it just about resource?
There is a difficulty, I would say. A lot of these forums that we've been at the past and various things is actually about planner bashing. Actually, as I say, we started, Craig McCann, we made some of those points, but actually, I can't say this, but I will say it anyway because I'm retiring, and you can. It's actually, we should have a hug a planner campaign to actually, what we need to, the whole point is it's a difficult job to be in because you're pleasing nobody, because there's a whole series of demands coming from different areas. So actually, how do you make that attractive? Well, actually, if you talk to young people at schools that we do, got school things, they're interested in the climate, they're interested in the environment, they're interested in what happens to the rivers, they're interested in building, they want somewhere to live, they want a job. Planning is about all these things. So actually, us being more proactive in terms of promoting planning as a profession, as a really interesting job with a whole variety of things that you can get involved in and make a contribution to. And that's what we got into planning the first point, was to make a difference, to make a contribution to our communities. So there's obviously there's a series of things that we, in terms of looking at sort of future planners programme, but how do we look at a range of options to get things? But there's an awful lot more we could do, and there's an awful lot more we could do in terms of talking up the profession and what it's about, and the influence and that contribution we can make to society and to our places that we live and work and play.
Okay, and my last point. In the last couple of weeks, we've had the Millard Homes ruling. What impact do you think that will have on future developments?
we'll see some applications coming through the system now, perhaps. Obviously, from a lot of those decisions, we say, one, in my view, it provides clarity. It is a good decision. It lets us move on from that legal challenge position. And let's talk about how we deliver these sites. Let's not. Mm-hmm. The whole point Matlow was brought in, whether you agree with the methodology or not, was to try and get us away from the arguments about housing figures, because we spent hundreds of thousands of, you know, as authorities, and time and effort and all the rest of arguing about numbers. What we should be doing is actually working together to see how do we deliver these? How do we sort of unpick the problems and actually make them work? So it's that whole point about collaborative working to sort of joint endeavour to make sure that we're delivering that, so we can see it in that positive way rather than it's all we're in court about numbers. Let's move forward from that.
OK. Anybody else want to come in on those points?
I think just on the issue of resourcing, I think planning fees has got a significant role in how we can resource our services. And I think there's simple things that could be done there. I think linking fees to inflation and having yearly increases that we can factor in helps us plan our resources. And so that would be, I think that would be a useful thing. And I think bearing in mind, of course, that a planning service isn't just about planning applications. To make a planning decision on an application, you have to have a development plan. And if we're going to have a successful planning service system, it's a system that needs to be enforced. So in Edinburgh, we deal with around 900 cases a year for planning enforcement. That needs its own resource. We're development planning is a continual process. It needs its resourcing. Listed buildings in Edinburgh, again, we have around 900 of those. We don't receive fees for those. So all of that work needs to be done in a time when no doubt government's budgets are under pressure, but certainly local government budgets are under significant pressure. I think looking at planning fees and simple measures to increase those fees, I think would be a real positive in terms of our ability to resource services. And I think it should also be borne in mind that there's a huge amount of work that planning services do when we're progressing applications and so on. But that is a proportion of actual development cost is very small. The fees that we bring in as a proportion of construction cost is very small. So I think that in that sense, there's a lot of bang for the buck in that sense. So an increase in fees would be very helpful.
Okay.
Thanks so much. Yeah, Morag would like to come in.
All right.
No, yes, thank you. Just to follow on from David there, resourcing is a big challenge for rural and island authorities, and it has been for a long time. Fees do not meet anything like what's required to staff a development management function, far less development plans and enforcement. However, planning is a fantastic job. It is incredibly interesting. It's incredibly diverse. It's a great career. And, you know, there just does need to be kind of more encouragement and support to get people in. There is also, like, just a need to recognise that, when we came out of college and university, you had four or five people you could go to ask questions, to learn. Now, young people are under huge pressure. You know, you come into departments where the pressure is to get turnaround decisions. There's a huge pressure to do with just the sheer volume of information that you have to process. So, you know, it's great to see, you know, the work that is being done by HOPS, you know, the Future Planners Project. But, you know, my concern really is that we've probably got a gap of years where people with experience are moving towards retirement, and the next generation coming in are going to, you know, need people to help them upskill.
Okay, thanks very much for that quite sobering point to end on, but I think a really important one. And we are trying in this committee we set out at the beginning of the session saying that we would like people to be excited rather than exercised by planning. So we're trying to do our bit to make sure that people understand. And I think your points that you were making, Ian, about young people who care about the climate and nature emergencies, this is And having a home to live and where the rivers flow is really important, offers a really important place for that. So thanks so much for joining us. And I, as always, wish we had more time because I feel like there was lots of tributaries there that we could have delved in further. But hopefully with this panel, the next one, the ones last week and some others, we are going to get a good picture. And I think already that is happening. So thanks so much for joining us this morning. And I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. I now welcome our witnesses on the second and final panel to the meeting. And we're joined by Esme Cleland, who's the Senior Conservation Planner, RSPB, and convener of the Link Planning Group, a Scottish Environment Link. Claire Daly, who's the Head of Policy and Communications at Sustrans and representative of the Climate Emergency Response Group. Claire Simons, who is the Chair at Planning Democracy, and Morag Watson, who is the Director of Onshore at Scottish Renewables. And we're going to turn to questions, but before I do, I just want to let you know that we will try to direct our questions to specific witnesses where possible. But if you'd like to come in, please indicate to me or to the clerks. And there's no need for you to operate your microphones. And if you could make sure that your gadgets are on silence, that would be great. I'd like to begin with the first question, which is around a sense of, or I'd like to understand if you have a sense if planning authorities and developers have changed their approach to development and decision making in the light of NPF4 policies on climate change and biodiversity. And I said I would direct my questions to somebody first, so I'll pass that to Claire first. I know that you'll all have different perspectives. Oh, sorry, yes, Claire Daly. So I'm going to ask an initial general question, then I'm going to come to a specific question for planning democracy. So, Claire Daly.
Yes, hi, I'm speaking on behalf of the Climate Emergency Response Group. In terms of how we're seeing changes in decision-making, I think it's certainly very early days, early to say. That being said, we are seeing evidence of NPF4 and Policy 2 being referred to. For example, where I work as well in Sustrans, NPF4 is being referred to on a regular basis in many applications for funding for infrastructure for walking, wheeling and cycling, for placemaking. And it is certainly something that is coming through, but it is very early days at the moment.
Well, hopefully we'll have you back or somebody from CERG to talk about it in a year from now. I'm just going to run along the line, actually. If we go to Morag, Esme, and then Claire Simons, and Claire, I'll come in with a specific bit about your work on biodiversity. Morag.
Thank you. Good morning, committee. We certainly have seen some changes in decision-making around the consenting of renewables. As the earlier witnesses said, NPF4 is very supportive of renewable energy, and we have specific examples where cases were making their way through planning, where they had been headed for refusal and now they are consented. Where we are seeing things that are less supportive, again, reiterating what was said in the earlier session, some of the policies are open to interpretation. The guidance to support those policies has not come forward yet. So while we are seeing very supportive decisions being made around renewables, we are seeing some decisions around conditions being added to it where the conditions are perhaps not based on the best available science. And you know, we heard earlier about the issues with peatland. Again, the peatland guidance is not where it needs to be at the moment, and it is not based on the metrics that we should be using according to science. So while NPF4 is working, the supporting guidance does need attention.
Okay. So you mentioned specifically peatland guidance. Is there any other guidance that hasn't come forward yet? Because I know the government's brought quite a lot of guidance forward, but is there something specific?
Again, is around policy 3 with the biodiversity. So the Scottish Government's own research found that the DEFRA metric is unfit for use in Scotland, particularly around the way it treats peatlands, and that a Scotland-specific biodiversity metric is needed. We are not expecting to see that biodiversity metric until 2025, so 2 years after we made biodiversity a top priority in our planning system. We still don't have an agreed way of measuring and evidencing what is being asked of people in development. And there's a real hunger for that to come forward.
OK, thanks. Esme, what are your thoughts from your perspective from Environment Link?
Yeah, I think we're seeing that there is a greater consideration of it. I think it's right what your previous contributors, especially Ian, was saying about your move to viewing development through that lens. And policy one does highlight that the global climate and nature crisis, you know, should be given significant weight. I think it's important to remember, and sometimes in decisions we're maybe not seeing it quite reflected, is that policy one does talk about the climate and nature crisis. So that's where it can become a bit tricky, and how you're balancing those things. So it is about both those things, but perhaps the nature side of that is sometimes given kind of less emphasis in reports that we're seeing. So RSPB Scotland did a very small amount of work through one of our volunteers looking at decisions which were made by the DPA and the Energy Consents Unit. And obviously that's quite a narrow type of development, but in summary, it was basically quite a variation in the way that decision makers were talking about NPF4, were talking about policy 3 especially. So absolutely agree that there is that significant support for renewable energy, which is obviously we need those renewables to tackle the climate crisis. But I think there is more kind of uncertainty about how to tackle the kind of other side of that, the nature side of it. And absolutely the guidance on the metric is not there. It's just at its very early stages in terms of developing the metric. But the Scottish Government guidance makes it clear that shouldn't stop people, from developers, from delivering enhancement through their proposals. So the metric is a tool for enhancement, but it's not the only way of doing it. And absolutely there's other ways that it can be done. But yeah, I agree that the guidance is, could be clearer. And it's about supporting local authorities to deliver what they're kind of trying to deliver, I think.
Can I just go in there a little bit on you're talking about in policy one, there's an uncertainty on how to respond to the nature requirements of it. Why is it so important? I mean, I think people really understand the climate emergency, but why, what's going on in nature that makes that so important, makes it high up in the level or the first thing you come to when you read NPF4?
Well, I think the reports that we see, the State of Nature report is a key report, which is which monitors the state of nature in this country and has seen those declines in the abundance and the diversity of nature. And I think it's just important to recognise that they're two sides of the same coin. They're absolutely intertwined, and it tends to be what you do for nature, what you do to enhance nature, is probably going to help tackle the climate emergency as well. And I think issues like how we deal with our peatland are obviously a key aspect of that. We have a finite amount of peatland in Scotland, and it is so important in tackling climate change, but it's also really important for the biodiversity and wildlife that we have in Scotland. And so appropriately valuing and measuring the impact on peat, I think, is key in development, not just in terms of the amount of carbon, but in the habitat that you're losing as well.
Okay, thanks very much. And I'm going to ask the same general question, if you want to respond to that, if there's anything to add, Claire Simons, but also if you could just describe, you've been doing a lot of research into the biodiversity policies, and it'd be interesting to get a little outline around what you've been finding there.
Well, thank you for inviting me. And it's really excellent that you're doing a review of the NPF4, which is a really good document. And it's really good to see, you looking into whether it's actually being implemented. So I'm pleased to be here. we started to look at this question of whether or not the biodiversity policies were being sort of implemented and how they were being implemented, largely because, our network of communities were repeatedly sort of asking the question, who's monitoring the enhancements? How are we going to know whether we're making a difference or not? How are we going to know if we're not making a difference, how many protected sites are being concreted over or whatever? And I think it's really important in terms of stressing the biodiversity side of things, because it seems to me it's a little bit of the silent crisis that's happening all around us, but perhaps maybe the older ones of us around, we can see some of the declines in some bird populations, maybe the lapwing, or we see less swifts and things, but, you know, there's other species that, you know, who knows about the Ivel sea anemone, you know, that went extinct the other day in the UK and is now globally extinct, but we don't know about that. So I think this is a real reason to focus on this. So we took a citizen science approach, and we enlisted 12 volunteers from our network, and I was surprised at how easy it was to do that. There was a lot of enthusiasm to trawl through planning applications and to look and see the reports of handling to see, and the decision notices to see how much they were focusing on the policy three. We looked at 347 applications from 12 local authorities, and the majority were local developments. The policy three was mentioned in 86% of cases, there was very little reference to the guidance, developing with nature guidance. And one concerning feature was that rarely were ecology officers or Nature Scot mentioned as consultees. Only in 3.4% of cases were they mentioned. conditions were only imposed in 83. That was only a quarter of the cases. So it felt, from our perspective, that while there was some level of consideration being given to the policy, it wasn't really resulting in any changes of approach in considering how these developments could be enhanced. And certainly considering biodiversity from the outset didn't seem to be something that was really being done. They were really relying heavily on the conditions. There was quite often conditions asked for a biodiversity plan to be submitted, and that's at the condition stage, and it should be happening far, far earlier, we felt. This was sort of supplemented by some of our more in-depth case studies where, you know, it's hard to see that they're looking at these developments at right at the early stages. You know, there's one in Potterton in Aberdeenshire where a proposal for 200 houses that's going to impact on a groundwater-dependent ancient woodland. And despite acknowledging the site abounds this ancient woodland, there was no assessment done by the developer of how that development's going to impact on that adjacent woodland with the runoff. And the developer was stating that, you know, usual tree planting, nest boxes. I think I might go into the nest box industry, actually, because that was the main condition. And forming some wetlands somehow comprised an enhancement. And yet those developer claims were totally unsubstantiated, it's very difficult to challenge them. And the community were raising that at every stage from the LDP onwards, and it just kept getting kicked down the road, right to, you know, far later in the stage. So I think we really have to do something about that. A lot of it seemed to be about mitigation rather than enhancement. A lot of the conditions. I think one of the things that the key findings was that, you know, death by 1,000 cuts, particularly with the local developments, which were the vast majority, as I said, of what we looked at. There was often sort of quite sweeping statements, there's no significant impact on green space biodiversity is envisaged. And so no biodiversity measures were considered. There was no sort of proactive way of looking at it. And one thing we noticed, one local authority, there was a number of water vole translocations. We were wondering about the cumulative impact in that local authority when there's several, you know, who's measuring how many water vole translocations are happening, which they're not always successful. So what's that impact overall on that species, which is declining. I think, there is a need for a mindset change, a culture change, perhaps to be more proactive, maybe a bit more enthusiastic about it. And I can see, you know, from the previous session, I totally understand the pressures that the officers are under, particularly looking at small applications. But, you know, we involved communities in the assessment of this, and I think there's a lot of room for this collaborative approach. And just to finish on a good case, we've been working with the community in Fife, and they've got together with Stirling Developments, who are bringing forward a development near Dunfermline of 1,200 houses. And we're hoping that they try and work much more collaboratively on the biodiversity as well as other aspects of the development. And hats off to Stirling Development. You know, they've sort of shared their biodiversity enhancement action plan. They've put the community in touch with their ecologist. So the community are really getting a look at things, and they're working together. And the community have formed a charity to focus on the biodiversity elements, so that the idea is that once the developer has gone and left, then the community can carry on and they can ensure that quality of enhancements are produced. So I think this is a good model. It's very, very early stages. It might go all pear-shaped. I think including the community as a partner is really important. I'll leave
great.
It at that.
Yeah, great. Thanks so much for that. That's really heartening to hear. And maybe that model in Stirling is something we'll get to see more of, because at the end of the day, it is, as you say, the people, the community that are going to be living long after developers are gone. I'm going to just preface the next run of questions that we have. I modelled going across everybody, but we may not have time for that, although I recognise that each of you do come here today with a different perspective. So we'll go for come in if there's something really absolutely hasn't been covered in response. But I've got another question, which is around the we had that bit about the kind of climate and nature and those policies, but NPF4 has these basic six principles, including local living, compact urban growth, and a wider place principle, also just transition. And I'd be interested to hear, and maybe I will start with Claire Daly again. I would be interested to hear from your perspective, have those principles had any influence on the location and type of developments brought forward in the last year? And again, I recognise this conversation is quite early on in the existence of NPF4.
Sure. In terms of the principles, one thing I would say that from a climate emergency response group point of view, we want to see the acceleration of the guidance across the board, but particularly for policy 2 on climate mitigation and adaptation. That's just one point that I think needs to be brought through. Again, it is going to be early days, but we are, for example, seeing a range of examples that do take into account the just transition, local living. And much of this has been around before NPF4 was completed, but I think what NPF4 gives, it strengthens that and gives it a context. Getting the balance, though, between guidance and, I know one of the earlier witnesses talked about, should rather than must, as much as possible rather than must. And I think better guidance, notwithstanding local context, engagement with local communities is really, really important. But at the same time, overarching guidance, whether we're talking about biodiversity, whether we're talking about local living. There's some interesting, very interesting examples happening, like we've heard earlier today from City of Edinburgh Council on some of what they're doing that takes into account local living, getting most of what you need within a 10 to 15 minute walk of where you live. That, of course, needs to be supported by things like walking, wheeling and cycling, and public transport routes, so that there's a reduced car dependency. But again, this is coming through. There are other very good examples. For example, Leave and Mouth in Fife, which of course is one of the projects mentioned in NPF4. But in some aspects of projects, you will have fantastic ambition, but then when ambition meets reality and meets funding, that can be problematic. So resourcing of local authorities for planning, resourcing of local authorities for, again, we heard about, you know, getting the new generation of planners up and coming. And there is evidence of climate and biodiversity starting to be taught in, you know, architecture and planning schools. But getting the resources, getting people, getting the capacity to interact with planning, I think would be a really, really important thing.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Would anyone else like to come in on the kind of sense of whether the six principles are actually having an impact? Are we seeing that already coming in? Claire Simons and then Morag.
Okay. Yeah, I think the housing policy in NPF4 is policy 16 on quality housing is better than the SPP. Obviously, because of the court challenges, we haven't been able to see exactly how it's working and being implemented. But I think in terms of compact urban growth, we have to be careful that we don't put too much focus on building our way out of a housing crisis, because I think that's very inefficient in terms of land use, and it kind of ignores the inherent environmental impacts and uses up considerable amounts of our carbon budget. So much is made of planning being inefficient, but it's, I think, actually the development industry model that's inefficient. You know, house builders want a generous supply of land, but the more generous that supply is, the harder it is to plan for infrastructure, and the more you're actually planning for urban sprawl, I think. So in large-scale allocations, you know, it tends to drive it towards low density, and that often falls short of the principles of good housing and neighbourhood design. So perhaps a key spatial principle could be to deliver only necessary and acceptable development using as little of our carbon budget as possible whilst making habitat and ecosystems a spatial priority. And you know, there is already a lot in NPF4 about you know, meeting need from existing stock, but I think it needs to be taken more seriously, and there are things that could be done maybe around VAT and their changes and things like that. I think you've heard about that in previous sessions, but yeah, I think that's
great. Thank you very much. Morag.
Thank you. The main one of the principles that I want to talk about is the just transition. And again, it's a very important principle and worth remembering in the energy context where it came from. We all remember in the 80s, as our coal industry was shut down, the impact that that had on the communities there, which generations later persists. We know that our oil and gas industry is coming to an end. It employs 1 in 5 people in Aberdeenshire, which is my home area. And again, should all those jobs be lost with nowhere for those people to go, the economic impacts would be huge. So it is one to which we pay very, very close attention. And again, it is a place where the interpretation is very open in NPF4 and has been causing some problems. So in terms of onshore wind, we spent 12 months negotiating an onshore wind sector deal with the Scottish Government, which was signed in September 2023, where there was a year-long process of negotiating what socio-economic benefits should onshore wind deliver in return for meeting our climate change targets. And it was all set out. We're actually publishing a report today that will be put out, that's been done in collaboration with the Scottish Government, identifying the numbers of jobs that we are going to need to bring forward. And I'll just quote the figures because it's a new publication. I haven't got them in my head yet. We currently employ around 6,900 people in 2024. By 2027, we'll need 20,500 people. So we are growing exponentially. Our other huge challenge is a great many of the contracts that we need to place are in construction. So we've already seen from the Construction Industry Training Board, they have looked at the construction capacity in Scotland, and they need an additional 19,950 extra construction workers in Scotland before 2027. But what we're seeing is conditions trying to be placed on planning with councils expecting payments around socioeconomic benefits when the policy was very much sitting in the space of creating jobs and supply chain opportunities. So that is one where we have seen some strange interpretations of policy.
Okay, that's very helpful. I just want to... There's big figures, big step between where we're at now in terms of employment and the just transition aspect of MPF4 that's supporting that. And I may be going a little bit off piece, but I just really wonder, having encountered somebody who, quite a lot of people who, on my commute from home to Edinburgh, I often go through the Aberdeen area, and I often encounter folks who've just come offshore or about to go, have just come onshore and are about to go offshore. And talking with them, I mean, the kind of the job package they get, all of that kind of thing, is very, very attractive, startlingly attractive, actually. And I just wonder what the renewable sector is able to do in terms of starting to attract people to renewables. And one person I was talking to recently was saying, oil and gas is still the way to go. So there's some work to be done there in terms of helping people understand the opportunities.
Yes, absolutely. And the issue is as black and white as oil and gas pays more. If you are already working in oil and gas, you are probably earning 20% more than you would in an equivalent role in renewables. But the cost of energy from fossil fuels versus the cost of renewables are very different, which is why there's a pay discrepancy there. So while people have jobs in oil and gas, it is very, very hard to attract them across to our industry. However, we do know that the supply chain, particularly, they are seeing their contracts beginning to dry up. There's not new developments in offshore. There's not new rigs coming forward. So they're looking very much now at moving into renewables. And our supply chain development statement shows that 100% of the supply chain companies we spoke to had been recruiting new roles focused solely on renewables. To give you an idea of how much of a recruitment crisis we have in our industry, SSE, one of our biggest companies, they have tripled in size in recent years. I have been with Scottish Renewables for 5 years. I have a team of four. I have recruited 12 times in 5 years because I cannot hang on to staff long enough. And part of the planning crisis that we see in our local authorities has to do with my members poaching planners from local authorities. We are desperate for staff, but there's a limit to what we can pay if we are to keep energy prices low, and that's where the difference comes. But we are aware that oil rigs will be decommissioned in the coming years, over the next 10 years, and on some oil rigs there can be crews of up to 600, and if those 600 people lose their jobs, their skills are extremely transferable to renewables, and they would be very, very welcome in the renewable sector.
Okay, great. So some work to be done there. I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald, who's got a... Oh, yes. No, apologies. Yes, Pam Goshall needs to leave before we end. So I'm going to bring in Pam with a couple of questions, and then I'll bring in Gordon.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, panel. The committee has heard concerns that some Scottish Government agencies, such as SEPA, has not adjusted to the policy priorities of NPF4. Is this the view you share? And if so, what action would you like to see such organisations take to reflect these priorities?
OK, who wants to start with that one? Shall I pick on someone? OK, Morag and then Claire.
This just reiterates a comment that's been made earlier. We have MPF4 and now the guidance needs to catch up with that. So peatland is beginning to become a little bit of a theme here. In the SEPA peatland guidance, peat, as soon as it is moved, is treated as waste. The idea that we have such a precious resource that we then label waste is rather out of step of where we are now. So again, through the Scottish Government's Peatland Action Advisory Group, that guidance is being looked at and updated. But that's the main place where we see a difference between where the agencies are at and where policy are at, is that need for guidance to catch up.
OK, thanks. Anybody else got anything to add there? Esme?
Yeah, I think just to agree that it's not necessarily so much an issue of catching up, but a greater clarity and guidance would be useful. But yeah, I'm not sure that that's particularly a problem resulting from NPF4. Yeah, just a bit of clarity on that would be useful.
Okay, I'm sure that the Chief Planner and her team are very busy on all of that kind of work. Pam, do you want to come in with your other question?
Thank you, Chair. We heard a lot in this committee that planning departments continue to lack resources to deliver an effective planning system. And just last week, we heard from Homes of Scotland, who said that changes to the planning fee system is not the answer, especially as they don't get the adequate service that they are looking for. The Scottish Government is funding 10 bursaries at £2,000 each for students to undertake planning postgraduate degrees. Is this enough? And what more can be done to increase in the number of planners? And do you think that changing the planning fee system will solve the resource issues in planning?
Esme, can I start with you? Yes.
Yeah. Obviously, there's a consultation out just now in resourcing the planning system, which is looking at a lot of these issues. It's quite a broad-ranging consultation, but includes a lot of questions about fees. So, yeah, I think as Scottish Environment Link has always, you know, kind of made that point that NPF4 and local development plans and the whole planning system will only work in what it's trying to deliver if it is properly resourced. So I think the increase in planning fees makes sense. And I think arguably you could only get a good service if you do have the funding for it. So I think it's kind of works both ways. But also I think previous contributors have made the point that even if it was full cost recovery for what actually the cost of determining the application, there are the other elements like development plans, enforcement, and how you would fund those things. And also the point that other people have made of really the recognition that planning plays in, you know, it's not just the processing of an application, it's how you build communities and make places and engage with the people in the area and how you're making the places that people want to live in and want to work in. So I think recognising the real value of planning is really important as well. So I think the fees potentially can address all those issues, but I think a lot of developers, I think, would be prepared to pay a higher fee if that meant, you know, a properly resourced service. And I think, I would absolutely agree with what previous people said, that you get a lot of bang for your buck in terms of the number of people that are involved in determining a planning application, the whole process. So I think it has to be, you know, it has to be reasonable, it has to be proportionate looking at the fees. But yes, I think the increase in fees would definitely help to start.
Thanks for that. I'm going to bring in Morag and then Claire Simons.
We totally disagree on the issue of fees and the raising of fees. We do agree that the planning service should be properly resourced, but there is no direct relationship between the fees that you pay for planning and the resources that a planning department has. Planning fees are not ring-fenced. They simply go into the general funding pot for a local authority. There are many, many calls on a local authority's budgets, which are deeply strapped at the moment, and there are many statutory requirements that get first call on that money. We had a long workshop session run by the Craig McLaren, the planning champion for planning improvement in Scotland, and everybody identified in the room that putting up planning fees would not improve planning unless there was ring fencing and there was a direct relationship. So we take a very different view on this. We are all in agreement that my members would happily pay more if it delivered a better planning service, but the mechanism at the moment is not an increase in planning fees because that money will not go to the planning department and therefore it will not help. And we've got to bear in mind that as you put up planning fees, what that does for our members is it puts up the cost of the electricity that they produce for the house builders. It puts up the cost of the houses that they build. So we end up in a sort of subsidy regime where we are adding costs across the board to energy, to homes and to other things. to pay for our local authority. Our local authority budgets should increase. They should be better funded, but this is not the mechanism to do it.
OK. I mean, I just want to clarify that you said you disagree, but it's not really necessarily the planning fee, it's the ring-fence nature.
The current mechanism that we have, putting up planning fees will not result in more resource for the planning.
Because we need to focus it in that direction. I think, Claire Simons, you wanted to come in.
I think you need to define what a better service is, I suppose, because if a developer puts in a fee and it's an increased fee, does that mean they expect the planning application to be more likely to be passed, or will it more likely to be faster and more efficient, or does it mean that we actually put more resources into biodiversity officers being able to scrutinise the reports and so on? And from a community's point of view, you know, where's the service for communities? Does that mean that planners will have more time to speak to them? So I agree. I think charging fees, I don't have a particular problem with charging more fees, but I think it's better in many respects that it comes from out with government. We should be properly funding our local authorities in many ways. But I would like to see charges for appeals. If a developer makes a planning appeal, why are they not? That takes up loads of time for planning officers. Why are they not being charged for those reapplications? Why are they allowed to even put in applications? I think Cool Links is a real good example, where an application that has already been done and dusted, it's been looked at, it's been thoroughly examined, and then it comes back a couple of years later, almost exactly the same. That is a time waster, and that shouldn't be allowed. So either make your system more efficient and get rid of those kind of pressures on the resources for the planners, or start charging for increased fees for reapplications and definitely for appeals.
Thanks. I'm going to bring in Claire Daly, and I'm going to move on to questions from Gordon MacDonald.
With just a really quick point to add to some of what has been said. We in the Climate Emergency Response Group certainly welcome the attention that's been brought to the need for resources for capacity and skills in the planning system, and the consultation that's been referred to on the Scotland's planning system. But all of these solutions are going to take time to build the profession, and what we would call for, again, taking an emergency climate emergency focus, would be to have interim measures that could be brought in quickly to plug the gap. For example, regional hubs that would draw down on expertise or have shared resourcing measures, because as I said earlier, we are seeing evidence of, NPF4, climate emergency, biodiversity starting to be taught in architecture and planning schools. But in the meantime, given that we have a climate emergency, what can we do? That might be one quick win.
Yeah, I think certainly the point of regional hubs did come up, I think, during some point when we were doing work on NPF4 last year. Gordon.
Thank you very much, convener. I wanted to ask you about the wording of some of the NPF4 policies. We heard some evidence last week that suggested, in one hand, that policy 3 on biodiversity was too loosely written, but the opposite was policy 22, where the flood risk was being very rigidly interpreted. So is there a problem that could lead to inconsistent decision-making because of the looseness or rigidity of the interpretation? How do we address it, and is it all about the guidance?
Pick that one up.
Esme first.
I think in part it is about the guidance. I think there's nothing inherently wrong with the wording of policy 3 in that it asks for that biodiversity enhancement, but there are a lot of questions that follow on from that, of how much is enough, how much is demonstrably better, how long does it have to be in place for, how is it secured, how do you calculate it, all those things. And the guidance was not in place for larger developments when the policy came into effect. So I think that is a big issue. And I think local authorities are trying to find a way through that. I think to a certain degree it's inevitable that there'll be a difference in interpretation depending on the local authority and what suits best. So what's probably appropriate for the Highland Council, which is geographically huge compared to Clackmannanshire, is going to be very, very different. But I think the draft guidance that's out just now from the government is a start. I think it will be revised, and I think it will need to be tweaked when we've learned a bit more from what's happening. And I think it does come down to having the expertise as well. If you have an in-house expert who can advise on ecology, I think it makes it obviously a lot easier for planners to do that. And also if you have that kind of strategic backing for the policy. So NPF 4 talks a lot about nature networks and policy 3 supporting those nature networks. So if you're a local authority once you've got that in place, you have something which maybe points to where there are opportunities for biodiversity enhancement, or you have a local biodiversity action plan, a lot of the heavy lifting is arguably done before the development even comes in. And I think that comes back to that kind of infrastructure first approach as well. If you're looking at nature networks as that green and blue infrastructure, it's there and you have your developments all kind of feeding into that. So I think that's really, really helpful if you have those things in place. And again, it's going to take time. The nature networks are still being rolled out and people are still understanding what they mean. But I think, having those tools will make it a lot easier in the future. But I don't think there's anything wrong with there being different interpretations in different local authorities. But what's really important is that it does apply to all the developments that it should apply to, and that we're ensuring that it is implemented and monitored and enforced. So I think the policy 3, there's an exemption for householders, which absolutely makes sense, but there's also an exemption for aquaculture in that policy. And I think that was, I understand, justified by the fact that that's kind of addressed through other marine plans, regional marine plans, but these aren't yet, in place. So I think looking at, again, maybe guidance on how planners then interpret how those kinds of developments can contribute to biodiversity as well would be useful.
Claire Daly, did you want to come in on that? I noticed you're taking some notes.
Yes, well, certainly on the point of the wording, coming back to that point, we would certainly agree that there's ambiguity, and maybe that is fine. But, for example, the delivery of policy 1 that gives significant weight to the global climate emergency in order to ensure that it's recognised as a priority in all plans and decisions. What is significant? What is significant weight? And then I think it was Morag Ferguson in the previous session from Corlin Nanilan Shear, that term as far as possible, there's a lot of that, and for policy 2, ensure that emissions for new development are minimised as far as possible. So this is where we get into the realm of should rather than must. We do look forward to guidance for policy 2 on mitigation and adaptation, because the planning and climate change guidance will, set an unequivocal signal for developers, the presumption that permission will not be granted for developments that lock in high carbon behaviours or developments that fail to incorporate adaptation to climate impacts in design. At the moment we are still having, for example, housing developments that or low density promotes suburbanisation. And again, talking from a Sustrans point of view, these are the very things that create car dependency. There's a huge opportunity, I should say, if we can look at housing and planning for less car use, for example, and that's something that, you know, in terms of Climate Emergency Response Group would agree for our town and city transformation proposals, that, for example, building at just slightly higher densities in nearer to city centres with excellent active travel and public transport links, you need fewer car parking spaces. They should not be, you can build at slightly higher densities, but also have green space, biodiversity, areas for biodiversity, for urban biodiversity, play space for children, and fundamentally livability. You know, so there are huge opportunities. But again, this would be something that we would hope would be considered in guidance.
Will guidance be enough to address those issues?
That's the question. I think we don't have anything other than, we can't go with anything other than guidance. But I think for developers, the feeling that there is a level playing field, and if quality is, and if all competitors are doing that, then it becomes a fairer ask. So I think clarity in guidance is going to be one of the most important things. You know, more direction, more clarity. Also then, again, if there are similar standards being used, then it's easier to compare and also to aggregate, you know, and this is, again, Climate Emergency Response Group would be advocating a net zero test. So if there is similar measurement in developments, then it's easier to aggregate the overall benefits of a policy and carbon emissions reductions of a policy.
Morag, you wanted to come in?
I was going to move on to a slightly different policy, and that is policy 6, forestry and woodland. There is a specific issue with this that was not addressed at the time of MPF4, and it's to do with two specific members, which are our network companies in Scotland, so SSE Network in the north of Scotland and Scottish Power Energy Networks in the south of Scotland. And it's to do with ancient woodland. So we agree that it is an irreplaceable habitat and it must be protected. But these are regulated businesses and there's a legal obligation for them to connect anyone who wishes to be connected to the electricity grid. And under the regulation of Ofgem, you must do that at the least reasonable cost. And because these are long linear features, they do unavoidably, from time to time, come into contact with ancient woodlands. So we would ask that there was a change to the wording of MPF4. And I know that SSE Networks have put in written evidence to the committee, and this is taken from their written evidence that we fully endorse and support. It says, development resulting in the loss or deterioration of irreplaceable habitats, such as ancient woodlands and ancient or veteran trees, should be refused unless there are wholly exceptional reasons and a suitable compensation strategy exists. And we would argue that is needed for the very, very specific reason that no one in our country should be refused access to electricity. It is a policy that we do need to balance out. We have precedent for this where SSE Networks have had to come in contact with ancient woodlands down in Argyll. There was a very effective strategy put in place. They worked with the local community groups to enhance biodiversity across the area, but with the acknowledgement that there was some impact on an ancient woodland.
Okay. My other point, and I'll come to you, Morag, on it, is, again, last week we heard that there are particular challenges in the Highlands. And, you know, there's, as you've highlighted, there is a need for renewable energy infrastructure to be developed, yet it's on carbon-rich soil. So how do we get the balance right between protecting these areas and allowing development?
I think it's helpful here to clarify what we need. So while we have blanket bogs, we have peatland, we have carbon-rich soils, and we have peatland areas, they're not all the same thing. So What happens when there's a proposal to put a renewables development in an area? A very, very thorough peatland survey is done. Peatlands in Scotland, outside of the protected areas, renewable sites are probably better mapped than any other part of Scotland. And there's very clear legislation. You cannot build on deep peat. Anywhere where there's active blanket bog, so where the peat is still accumulating and active. But that only represents about 20% of Scotland's peatlands. 80% of them are degraded and damaged. So what would be standard practice in renewables development is, having done that peatland survey and your environmental impact assessment, you would use the carbon calculator, which calculates whether the carbon saved and the carbon release bound out. You would then put in place a peatland management plan. So you would microsite your infrastructure to avoid all the deep peat. Anywhere where there's active blanket bog, you wouldn't even touch. You'll have done a hydrological survey of the site to check how the water flows might change. We will put in measures like floating tracks so they don't dig down into the water courses and change the water flow and so on. And those are all the standards measures that we would do. We are currently working through the Peatland Expert Advisory Group with the Scottish Government to bring the peatland guidance up to date, because it is a little out of date and out of step with the advice in MPF 4. So that's the way it's done. The other thing I should say is, it is simply part of a renewables development. If you have peatlands on your site, you do peatland restoration. And it's something that our industry spends millions on. So, to give one example, Whiteley Wind Farm, which is Scottish Power Renewables, just outside Glasgow, one of Scotland's largest wind farms. Under MPF 4, they would have been expected to do about 10% compensation measures. They did 40% when they came to their peatlands. They just restored everything that they could. And again, there's ongoing monitoring to check that those peatland measures actually work. So what happens on renewable sites, because of the way we've developed as an industry, is very, very different from what would happen, for example, on a housing site.
Esme?
Yeah, I think it is an issue. And I think, as people have said before, that where there's a lot of wind, there tends to be a lot of peat, especially in the north of Scotland. Although there are policies about avoiding peat, I don't think it's quite as clear cut as what is deep peat, and that's always avoided. There are significant impacts on peatlands, and I think that's recognised in decisions. So one decision that's mentioned in the John Muir Trust submission that's been made to this committee was the Energy Isles Wind Farm, and I think in that decision to grant that application, it was recognised that there would be, impacts on peat, and that was balanced. And the decision was that the contribution in renewables was that it was acceptable. But I think it is quite a difficult balance to make, and how you assess it. I understand that work has been done on the carbon calculator just now, so I think it's recognised that there are issues with the carbon calculator, and that needs to be revised and that needs to be resolved. So absolutely support the work that's been done on that to make sure that there's a proper carbon audit so you can actually be making that informed decision. And I think in terms of the policy wording, it asks that development optimises the contribution of the area to greenhouse gas emission reduction targets, and without that proper calculator, you know, it's really difficult to make that balance. I think the other issue is the one about habitat, is that it's not just about carbon, it's about the habitat and the peatland that's supporting species and is part of that habitat. But absolutely agree that the renewables industry are in some areas doing huge amounts of peatland restoration, and that can be quite challenging in terms of finding areas to do that in. And I think SSEN's submission as well talks about that, of not having control over land and land ownership. So I think those are all absolutely valid points, and I think that there's obviously a variation between developers, but we've certainly seen really good examples of the willingness to do that restoration and a willingness to look at good practice in restoration as well. But ultimately, if you can avoid it in the first place, that's obviously better, but it's quite difficult. One of the issues that is arguably becoming increasingly a problem is that wind farms are determined without considering that infrastructure that they are needed and that has to be provided for them once they're consented. So if you have a wind farm proposal coming in, it won't show the grid lines that are connecting to it, although there's a recognition that if it is consented, it will, you know, SSEN or SPN will be obliged to make that connection. So if you have a wind farm which is even very carefully sited to avoid peat, but it is surrounded by, you know, great peatland, or it has ancient woodland and all those other kind of habitats, when the transmissions come to make that connection, then they're obliged to do that, and that can cause additional problems. So again, going back to a kind of infrastructure first approach, it would be really useful to have that taken into account when you're actually considering the wind farm developments themselves, because a lot of the issues are coming from the infrastructure as well as the wind farms.
I can see Morag, you want to come back before we come up
here? I need to make a correction there, because what Esme has said is not correct. So nobody would develop a wind farm unless they have a very clear understanding of how the grid connection will be, because otherwise you have built an asset and you have no route to sell your electricity. Although there's an obligation for the company to connect you to the grid, you have to pay for that grid connection. So if you were to go through a sensitive habitat, which it's unlikely you get permission for that, you would have to route round it. And grid connections are eye-wateringly expensive. Grid connection can cost more than the construction of a wind farm. So to say that this is not taken into consideration is actually not correct. It's a very, very prime consideration before building a wind farm.
Clear, yeah. Sir?
I think I was just going to say, I mean, I'm not saying the developer has not considered that at all, but it's not a requirement. It's not shown on the proposals, so it's not, the grid connection isn't shown. And I think we are seeing examples where they then do have to go through very sensitive habitats. So I'm not saying it's anything that, you know, anyone's intending or wanting to do, but, you know, it is correct that connections are being made through very sensitive habitats, and we've got current applications which we can give you examples of which show that.
Just a quick point. The Natural Places Policy is very clear. Development proposals, which by virtue of their type, location, scale, will have an unacceptable impact on the natural environment, will not be supported. But who makes that assessment of whether or not it's unacceptable? It's usually the applicant themselves, and I think this is a weakness in the system that needs to be rectified. And also, they are then required to make a community benefit statement, which the community have absolutely no say in what is that. They have no scrutiny process of that community benefit statement, and I think that's a weakness, because it's almost like an advert for the developer to be saying, look at what we're doing, but it's absolutely not up to scrutiny from the community itself.
Again, it's factually incorrect of what has just been stated there. Community benefit is not a material consideration in planning. It is a voluntary contribution. There is national guidance that everybody is expected to follow, which was developed with Local Energy Scotland around consultation with communities. And likewise, when it comes to the assessment of whether it's an unacceptable environmental impact, you must hire somebody who is accredited as an independent ecologist to assess this. They must put together evidence. That evidence must be submitted to Nature Scot, and Nature Scot will scrutinise that evidence to see whether or not it stands up. It is not simply a case of a developer saying, no, there's no significant impact, and everybody just accepts that. That is not the way it happens in planning.
Okay. Thanks very much, Kerry.
Okay. Thanks, Gordon. I'm going to bring in Miles with a couple of questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask a question in relation to brownfield sites and MPF4 policies around encouraging developers to build on these potential sites, and what else can be done to help support that. Specifically, we've heard concerns around decontamination costs around this. So just wondered what impact MPF4 has made, and if there's anything you wanted to put on the record with regards to that.
Really, just to say, perhaps there's a need to tackle the high land values of brownfield sites and maybe provide subsidies and incentives to help regenerate the land by providing public investment in preparing these sites for development and buying up land at existing use value and selling it to the house builders. That moves the profit incentive from extractive land value to encouraging a system where the markets compete on what is built and the quality of the build rather than making their profits on the rise in land values. And I think this should lead to better quality housing. And I think Scottish Land Commission have done a lot on this, but I think we've really got to go for addressing the fundamental problems of land values. I believe it was a manifesto commitment, and I think we've got cross-party agreement on that now. So I think it's a bit of a missed opportunity with the recent land reform bill not to have tackled that land value capture aspect, but that might have possibly helped in terms of incentivising more brownfield development.
Anyone else? Anything they want to add to that? If not, I wanted to move on with regards to the delivery of infrastructure first approach, which was part of MPF4, and specifically whether or not there's been any changes around that. I know here in Edinburgh, the West Edinburgh Green Network has specifically looked to connect what is going to be the growth in our developments in the west of the city so that they're connected for both walking and cycling and for that to be embedded. But also, I think one of the things, and maybe bring yourself in, Morag, around this, is the grid upgrade, but also the renewable projects which are coming forward. Potentially housing will be one of the biggest problems for workforce, and just wondered what work was going on, which wasn't necessarily outlined with MPF4, but industries taking forward as well. So I don't know.
We're just going to have to say, we're going to have to go to keeping our questions and answers brief.
I can start then in that case. In terms of the grid infrastructure, yes, we are going to need over £20 billion of grid upgrades in order to make a network fit for net zero. Those applications aren't due to come into the planning system until this year. An issue we have highlighted is the capacity of the planning system to deal with them. So in terms of how that will play out in the planning system, it's too soon to tell. In terms of the housing issues, again, in line with SSE Networks' submission that they have given to you, they are going to need 9,000 extra staff to deliver all this. They're already looking and in negotiation with housing associations in Highland to build 200 houses that will be used probably for about 3 to 4 years to house their workforce and then turned over to the housing associations to provide additional housing. So in terms of those issues, yes, they are serious ones for concern. How they're playing out in the planning system, it's too soon to know.
Claire Daly, did you indicate you want to come in?
Yeah, I think it's just making a point I made earlier, again, about looking differently at densities and the infrastructure first approach. We had been seeing this prior to MPF4 anyway, but MPF4 strengthens and consolidates that. But again, looking at how we create public transport, active travel links, and also local infrastructure, schools, green spaces, will certainly help. And I think going back to your previous point about brownfield sites, again, where things are located and where housing is located and a rethinking of housing, where housing is located, I think can have a very positive impact.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with a final two questions.
Thanks very much, convener. Morag, I want to come to you first. Something you said earlier really struck me. You were talking about just transition and you referred to the coal mining era in Scotland in the 1980s and you compared that with the just transition in the North East that we're experiencing. There was no just transition in the 1980s then. It was basically a like it or lump it transition, wasn't it? And the words like local place plan weren't in the lexicon then for many communities in Scotland. We just didn't think that way. So I'm glad that we are now, we're talking this kind of language. So it was really just to get some final thoughts from all of you about how local place plans are developing. Are they working? Are they beginning to work? Are we seeing the fruits of this at the moment? Just to get some ideas and some contributions from you about this. So start with Morag, since I mentioned you.
Certainly. So local place plans is not something that the renewables industry particularly gets involved in. We tend to be somewhat more remote from communities. But in terms of the community benefit that we do put into communities, I have to check my exact figures here, but I can do that for you, that it is 108 million that we have put into communities in recent years. And a lot of that money is actually paid to things like Local Development Trust to support them to have the capacity to engage in these things. We heard in the earlier session talking about communities and the capacity that they can have to bring forward a plan. So it actually is in the good practice guidance for community benefit that this is one of the key things that we support communities to do, is to help them with their plans and then to help fund the delivery of those.
Other colleagues, how do local place plans work? Are they working, they're beginning to emerge? And how do you see them influencing local development plans as we go forward? Claire?
Sorry.
Claire Simons.
I was wondering how many local place plans you need to have in an area to influence a local development plan. You know, if you wanted to change the policy on PBSA in Edinburgh, how many local place plans would have to agree on that to sort of have that put forward into the local development plan. I think we haven't got enough at the moment to make that judgment. I think the Planning Act required that you do a review after 7 years. So that will be in 2026 of local place plans. So maybe that's the thing to be scheduling in to your timetable. But the feedback we're getting on the timing, I think it's really is that, and maybe it answers the reason why there aren't so many in Edinburgh, is that people find it really hard to engage in the local development plan process at the same time as trying to do a local place plan. It's usually the same sort of people that are interested in planning and trying to get to grips with MPF4 as well so that it takes account of it. It's just overwhelming for people. So I think there's something around the timetable, how to fit that in with the process.
Any comments, Esme, Claire, Daly?
Just to say the development of local place plans, it's certainly a significant stage in the process of implementing NPF4, and it's an opportunity for policy to be properly localised, and great opportunity for consulting with communities, involving communities. But again, going back to the point, and we heard earlier from some of the local government officials, it's early days. You know, the fact that there are only three in Edinburgh is revealing, but perhaps, you know, in time that will improve.
Esme, any comment on it?
Yeah, I think I wouldn't have too much more to add apart from, I think there are great opportunities, but it'll be a bit of wait and see how that plays out. And I think it would be really interesting if the Scottish Government was able to kind of do that kind of review and see how they were working, you know, before that seven years in trying to identify if there was issues, what there were, if there was any barriers for people to taking part. And just on the just transition point that we were making before, I think it's absolutely right, you know, the points about the opportunities that renewables have for just transition. And I think there's quite a lot of things that go along with that, and the wider biodiversity policies, the requirement for more habitat management plans, more kind of peat restoration, all those kind of, there's jobs that go through that kind of environmental work. And those are, you know, it's a long-term thing. These aren't just kind of go in and do it. Those will be long-term over a number of years. So I think it's those kind of direct in terms of just transition, but also everything that potentially flows from that as well.
And just finally from me, we've kind of touched on it during the discussion, but one of the six principles is about rural revitalisation. And Claire, you were talking from SusTrans' point of view about town centre urban developments and making it accessible so we don't need cars. But what about the rural setting? I appreciate maybe a few comments from colleagues about that. Is NPEF strong enough to support, encourage or otherwise, you know, rural, sustainable rural development, particularly community-led housing and so on? Any views or comments on that finally, please?
Touch briefly on that. This is, again, one of the key things that we've brought forward about the renewables industry, that it is dispersed across Scotland, that it brings jobs and long-term, well-paying professions to remote and rural parts of Scotland. We've seen the impact that oil and gas had in the northeast of Scotland and the affluence that exists there. And again, as a just transition, having that kind of affluence spread around Scotland, you know, on the islands, up in the Highlands, Dumfries and Galloway, out in Argyll, these are all places where we are offering jobs. We are currently looking for welders in the Highland at £75,000 a year, and we can't get them. So if anybody's looking to retrain, so, you know, just to give you an idea, these things are not separate. So our just transition, our energy transition, tackling the climate emergency. Another key thing that we have a huge demand for is people to do the peatland restoration. We do not have enough professionals who can do that. So these things all combine together to be a good news story for our rural areas if we can bring it all together in a coordinated way.
Thanks, Morag. Any final comments from other colleagues on that?
You heard from Community Land Scotland earlier, and I would agree with what Elsa was saying. Communities having to deliver quite a lot of these developments in rural areas, and you know they're very outcome focused as well. And I think that should be applauded and supported as much as possible.
Thanks very much, everyone. Thank you.
Yep. Okay, great. Thank you very much. I can, again, another panel where I feel like we just scratched the surface, but I'm hoping that we'll get a fuller picture from hearing from all of the panels in as one group together. So now, just want to say thanks so much for joining us this morning. I think it's been really helpful. And I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow you to leave the room. The next item on our agenda this morning is to further consider the following negative instrument: Town and Country Planning General Permitted Development Scotland Amendment Order 2024. There's no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. I'd be interested to hear if any members have any comments on the instrument. No? Okay. So it's noted that this is the last phase of the Scottish Government's Permitted Development Rights Review, and it suggested that the committee may wish to write to the Scottish Government asking it to set out its next steps and what it intends to do to consider the impact of the changes made through the three phases of the review. Are members agreed to write to the Scottish Government in these terms? Agreed. We're agreed. Is the committee otherwise agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument? Agreed. Thank you. We're all agreed. We previously agreed to take the next three items in private, so as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.